I want to look with you in this video at the conclusion of Paul's letter to Philemon. It's another example of the different ways that closing material can be used that we find in Paul's letters. As I read it, the closing of Philemon begins in verse 21. And notice that in this short letter, the closing too is shorter than the closing in the three pastoral letters that we've already looked at this week. The closing of Philemon begins in verse 21 with a brief peroratio in a single verse. I'm confident, Paul says, of your obedience, as I'm writing to you, knowing you will do even more than I say. With these words, Paul sums up his appeal to Onesimus that makes up the body of the letter of Philemon. And he does it in an interesting way. The words he uses in this peroratio are important to understand. Let's take time to look at them carefully. First of all, I'm confident, Paul says. The confidence Paul expresses is based in the word he chooses and the way the word is used grammatically. Together, these things mean that Paul has been and continues to be persuaded that Onesimus will respond positively to his appeal, that he will respond in the same way to this one in the present as he has responded to Paul's teachings and appeals and exhortations in the past. What were those past experiences that Paul is drawing on as the source of his confidence? They have already been described in the letter. If we take this part of the peroratio and look back for how it relates to the letter's content, we notice that in the opening of the letter, in verse 1, Paul addresses Onesimus as our beloved fellow worker. That address tells us Onesimus has worked alongside Paul and Timothy in the past. That's part of the basis for Paul's confidence that Onesimus will listen to his appeal in the conclusion. Not only that, but Paul's past experiences with Onesimus are indicated in verse 7, where Paul says that he has, and I'm quoting now, derived much joy and comfort from the love of Onesimus. The word used here for love is agape, the word for self-sacrificial, self-sacrificing love. This is the kind of love Paul encourages the Philippians to find, to bring about unity among them, and the kind of love that Paul illustrates using the example of the self-emptying life and love of Christ in Philippians 2, 1 through 11. The appeal Paul makes to Onesimus in Philemon depends precisely on that kind of love, that self-giving, self-sacrificing love. It depends in Philemon on Onesimus being willing to sacrifice what would be best for him in terms of his honor, his reputation, and his status. For those things demanded that he severely punish a runaway slave, even if the slave returned. N.T. Wright highlights this point in a video I've included in the module as a supplementary video that you may watch if you like. It's excellent, but it's not required. The next words Paul writes in the peroratio, after he says, I'm confident, are usually translated with the phrase of your obedience. And the word Paul uses does imply that in conceptual terms. It does imply obedience in terms of concept. But in pictorial terms, what it describes is a process of first listening and then following some course of action that's being advised or recommended. And that kind of language sounds much more like the kind of language that Paul would use for someone he considered a fellow worker. For the phrase of your obedience implies, as we've seen, a command, but Paul instead makes an appeal for Onesimus to listen and then follow Paul's advice. Paul calls Onesimus a fellow worker, not as though he is someone superior, but someone advising or giving counsel to Onesimus. So as Paul says to Onesimus in this letter, I'm confident of your obedience as I'm writing to you, knowing you'll do even more than I say. Now we can see much more clearly what Paul is really saying in this single sentence summary, this per oratio. He is summarizing his appeal to Onesimus. He is appealing to Onesimus as a fellow worker, appealing to him as one who in the past has demonstrated his love, his agape love, by demonstrating his willingness to sacrifice his own self-interests for the sake of his Lord Christ. And Paul is appealing to Onesimus to do exactly the same thing once again in the name of and for the sake of the Lord Jesus. That's why Paul concludes his appeal in verse 20 with the words, refresh my heart in Christ. Because in the past, Onesimus has, as Paul says in verse 7, done exactly that. Paul writes in verse 7 how he has derived much joy and comfort from your love in the past. And because Paul and Onesimus share this kind of relationship and these experiences with each other in Christ as fellow workers, although he could, Paul does not command, but rather appeals with confidence, believing that Onesimus will listen to his counsel and follow its recommendation, the one Paul makes in verse 17 when he says to Onesimus, so if you consider me your partner, receive Philemon as you would receive me. The next element in the conclusion of Philemon is a request. Paul requests to stay with Onesimus, for he's hoping to be released through the prayers of Onesimus and others from his prison in Rome and be granted the gracious gift of being able to return to Onesimus. And not only Onesimus, but because the you in verse 22 is plural, it refers to the rest of those who are addressed in the opening of the letter. Apphia, our sister, Achippus, our fellow soldier, and the whole church that meets in your house. One of the interesting dynamics in Philemon is its dual nature, as a letter addressed primarily to an individual, but addressed to that individual as a member of a Christian community that meets in his house, and as an individual who relates with Paul to Apphia and Archippus. By naming these people, Paul is subtly framing his appeal so that it is an appeal not only to the relationship between himself and Onesimus as fellow workers, but to other fellow workers, other Christians as well, and to the whole community of Christ in Onesimus's home, who will hear this letter and be watching to see if Onesimus will continue to behave counterculturally and demonstrate the self-sacrificing love of Jesus Christ. The sense of the community that surrounds Onesimus as he listens to and decides whether or not to respond positively to Paul's appeal is broadened further in verse 23 by those who join with Paul in sending greetings, closing greetings along with the letter. Mark, Aristarchus, and Luke are other fellow workers of Paul, as Onesimus is. They too, by sending their greetings in this closing, join with Paul in making the appeal, and they will be watching and trusting along with Paul that Onesimus will respond with agape love. Then last in this letter comes the concluding grace, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's directed as a prayer toward the spirit of Onesimus. Interestingly enough, those same words are used in the concluding grace in only one other letter of Paul, Philippians. And in that letter, as we've already mentioned, is held up this same self-sacrificing, self-emptying love of Christ as the basis for unity. I suspect that is no accident. So all in all, there are several elements in the conclusion of Philemon, an important per oratio, or summary, a request based upon a personal hope that Paul expresses as a point of information. He hopes to be able to come and stay with Onesimus after he has been released. That's his hope. Greetings that Paul gives and others add to as they join with Paul in sending the letter. And a closing grace directed to the spirit of Onesimus, the spirit that will animate his decision and his action. And Paul is hoping that that grace will be the grace that persuades Onesimus to act in self-giving, self-sacrificing, agape love. I hope you've enjoyed our look this week at the closings in Paul's letters, in the pastorals, and in the letter to Philemon. And I hope you've been able to see how they provide us with important information that really does help us understand the letters as a whole. I hope you'll be able to use your analysis of the closing of Paul's letters with Paul's other letters to continue to see the messages that God has placed within them, not only for their original audiences, but for you and me as well.